are so glad that you joined us today. We want to encourage you to subscribe to our channel and to help us better spread the gospel. Please like and comment below. If you are ever in the Nashville, Tennessee area, we would love for you to be our special guest, and you can visit our website for service times and events. We are so glad that you joined us today. We want to encourage you to subscribe to our channel, and to help us better spread the gospel of Jesus Christ, please like and comment below. If you are ever in the Nashville, Tennessee area, we would love for you to be our special guest, and you can visit our website for service times and events. Thank you.
If you walked in sick, you're gonna walk out healed. And if you walked in bound, you're gonna walk out free. 'Cause just the mention of his name, just the mention of his name, just the mention of his name, everything can change, everything can change. If you walked in heavy, you're gonna walk out light. If you walked in weary, you're gonna be alright. 'Cause just the mention of his name, just the mention of his name, just the mention of his name, everything can change, everything can change. If you walked in down, you're gonna walk out up. If you walked in empty, he's gonna fill your cup. It's just the mention of his name,
just the mention of his name,
just the mention of his name.
Bow down and say you are God. just wanna be here. King of glory, fill this place. I just wanna be with you. Oh, I just wanna be with you. Sing yes the word.
Yes the word.
As you are, just as you are, it's time to come home out of the dark.
Come on, can you give that Savior praise in the house today? Come on, can you lift your voice, your heart, your praise to Him? Let the difficulties of the day wash away as you focus on the Lord. He really is just a call upon Him away. His name is Jesus. So simple. Your Bible tells you in 1 Corinthians chapter 1 and in verse 18 that the cross, to those that are perishing, those that are lost, it's foolishness. You know that. They wear it around their neck, but it doesn't have any meaning to them. But to us, the Bible says that the cross is the power of God. In other words, that's where Jesus Christ took our place, what belonged to us. He lived the life we could not live, and He died the death that we deserved. And that's why it is the power of God. He was on that cross in our place, atoning for you and I. And all that we need to do is repent of our sin and call upon the name of the Lord. And it's that simple. You can be saved. But as a believer, you can use that name against all the works of darkness, because it is the name above every single name, of things in heaven, things in earth, and things under the earth. Can we give our Lord Jesus one more big praise in the house? Come on, bless His name today. Come on. Praise you, Jesus. We thank you that you are the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. You're the Lord of glory, the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end, the Rose of Sharon, the Lily of the Valley, the Prince of Peace, and we bless you. The name above every single name. Let all that we do tonight magnify the matchless name of the Lord Jesus Christ. You can be seated in the house tonight. Welcome, everybody. It's our privilege to have you. So blessed to have you in the house of God. If you're brand new here, watching with us online for the very first time, do want you to know just a little bit about us before we get started. And I hope you'll find this good news here at Joy Church. We are not religious. Never have been, never will be. Always about a relationship with a loving Heavenly Father through His one Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. You're a joy, not about tradition. Always about the Word of the living God. And at Joy Church, made a determination a long time ago. Me and the Moores, we're not going to endure our Christian life here at Joy Church. We're going to enjoy it. You and I can, and we should enjoy our Christian journey together. Welcome, everybody. Thrilled to have you in the house of God. I'm going to ask my very favorite Connection pastor. He's going to come and officially welcome you here this evening. As Pastor Eric comes, can you give him a big encouragement?
Hey, everybody. Happy Wednesday to you. On behalf of Pastor Jim and Miss Ann, we're so honored that you're here, whether you're joining us live here in-house or via the interwebs. Thank you so much for joining us on this Wednesday night. I know you're going to be blessed. Now, while you guys are being served a great meal tonight from the Word of God, our children have awesome ministries going on. Pastor Ryan and his team are serving our younger kiddos over in the children's area. And over in the landing tonight, our youth is having a very special time over there tonight as well. So we're super excited that you're here. Something that we love to do before we go any further, we love to welcome all of our first-time guests. So we don't want to embarrass you or single you out. We just want to let you know how glad we are that you're with us today. We've got a very special packet that we'd love to get in your hand. Inside that packet, you'll find a coupon that looks like this. It's for a free drink at our Cup of Joy. That's our drink station right here in the main building, in the main hallway here at Joy Church. And attached to that coupon, you'll also find a blue card. That's our connection card. It'll take just 30 seconds to fill that out front and back. That'll help us better serve you in the future. So if you're with us for the very first time and you'd like that free gift, go ahead, raise your hand high in the air right now, or ushers will come by and get that to you. That's right. Yeah, come on. Let's encourage our guests. Yeah, something else we love to do here at Joy Church, we love to celebrate the opportunity to partner with God through the faithful giving of our tithes and offerings. We know that we're not paying a debt off to God, but we're actually getting to partner with Him and seeing lives change because we're able to share the love of Jesus Christ all over this world. As we sow into Joy Church here, Joy Church is sowing into ministries that go places that we can't go. It's not just here in Middle Tennessee. No, it goes not just nationally, but internationally as well. We're seeing ministry. We're helping ministries in Guatemala, in Honduras, in Romania, in Russia, in the Ukraine. Guys, what an opportunity we have to share the love of Jesus Christ. That's why God gives to us out of his love. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. Out of his love for us, he's given us his very best. And now we have the opportunity to give him our best because of our love. What an awesome opportunity we have. We made it super simple for you to give. If you're joining us via the internet or our live stream, you could go to the Give tab there or go to joychurch.net/give. If you prefer to mail your gift in, you could do that at the address you see on the screen right now. Or all those options are available to everybody who's live here in-house. You can use those options as well. But our usher's going to come by in just a moment to serve you. You'll find envelopes in the seat back in front of you or on the chair beside you. Take a couple minutes. Just fill that out. Our ushers will be right by and be able to collect that. Guys, what an awesome opportunity we have. Let's just be thankful through our giving tonight. Let's pray. Father, in Jesus' name, we just thank you so much, Father God, for your love for us. We thank you that we get to share that love, not just here locally, but all over the world. I thank you, Father God, that you bless this, multiply it in your hands, use it for your kingdom so that we can see more and more people coming to know the love of Jesus Christ. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Guys, there's all kinds of amazing things going on here at Joy Church. We've got a little video to tell you more about it. Check it out.
Join us this weekend as Pastor Jim begins a brand new series, More Blessed, Live to Give. You don't want to miss this. We'll see you there.
Have you heard about the food pantry ministry here at Joy? Every week we're helping to serve those in our community who need food assistance, and we're sharing the love of Jesus. You can make a difference by donating non-perishable food 30 minutes before each service at the food pantry in the landing, or drop it off at the office during office hours. Go to guest services for a complete shopping list. We deeply appreciate your continued support of the food pantry ministry here at Joy. Lives are being changed.
Hey ladies, in these uncertain days that we're in, it is so important that we stay anchored to God and to his word.
And we want to help you do that and stay strong in the Lord.
So come join us for our final event this year, our spring brunch. This will be a great way to connect with new friends, enjoy a delicious catered brunch, and be encouraged. Because this brunch is catered, we have a firm deadline to register. So be sure to register by Sunday, April 21st.
Bring a friend and let's stay anchored
together.
Where are all my dudes? Men's Conference, Heart of a Champion, is coming up on Saturday, April 20th. There's going to be tons of food and fun, and we're welcoming a special guest speaker, Cameron Babb, who's a former wide receiver for Ohio State. So make sure you sign up by visiting our friends at the men's desk in the main hallway or go online at joychurch.net/events. This is for all men ages 13 and up. So bring your son, bring your dad, bring your crazy uncle. Just grab some friends because you don't want to miss this. It's going to be awesome.
Of wonderful things happening at your wonderful church. Please be a part of what God is doing. Got some quick pastoral announcements that I do need to make very excited about. As you know, Cam Babb is right now ministering to our teens, and we're very excited about that. And then we are also very excited to let you know tomorrow we've got our college and career age folks, and Cam is going to be ministering down at Kairos. Now, you don't need to register if you're college. age, come on, 18 to 27 years old. That is tomorrow, 7 o'clock. You don't want to miss it. It will be a big blessing to you. Also, I do want you to please be aware that Saturday, our men's conference, very excited about that. Cam will be ministering there as well. Sign up, register. You need to register for that. You can register online or in the guest services before you leave. That's this Saturday, men. If you are a man and you should know who you are, come on and be a part of that this Saturday. We'd be so blessed. Speaking of so blessed, everybody say this weekend. Very excited to let you know this weekend we're beginning a brand new series, Ashley, entitled More Blessed. We want you to be a part of what God is doing. Live to give. Listen to me very closely. This is one of the most fun lives that you can imagine. I just had the opportunity to give something to somebody, made that somebody smile. That somebody is special to me. We're very excited. We had an opportunity today to surprise somebody here at the church, somebody special. There were lots of tears. We're going to show you a video of it later, not today, but later on down the road. Our church, myself, our team, we live to give. And I'm telling you, when you do, like Alan does or the Smithsons do, I'm telling you, your Christianity will become enjoyable again. As long as you are self-centered, I'm telling you right now, your Christianity is going to be miserable. You could be on your way to heaven, but have a really miserable life here on this earth. When you learn, it is more blessed, Acts 20:35, more blessed to give than to receive. I think of the Underwoods back there. They give all the time. They are very happy people because they give all the time. And right away, everybody's mind goes to finances. Don't just think finances. Think smiles and love and baking and mowing my lawn. You, not my lawn, but somebody's lawn. And think about giving. There's so many different creative ways to do that. We had a little special young lady that was at our Taste of Joy on Friday. She's 28, but she has Down syndrome, but she's just the cutest little thing that you can imagine. And she was there at her Taste of Joy with her mom and dad, and she could, you know, she could converse fairly well, and she just had this big old infectious smile. And I really connected with her. Her name is Bridget. She's my little buddy. And we were talking together, and she just stood up and she said, my birthday's in October. And we found out that she loved flowers, and so we gave her a rose, and then when we found out she really loved them, we gave her two roses. And then we're going to actually surprise her if she comes this Sunday with something else more fun. This is just so fun. Now, listen to me very closely. Guess who's just happy as can be about that? Me. It is almost selfish to be a giver. Because I can't wait for this weekend because I have an opportunity to bless somebody. You say, well, Pastor, you shouldn't do that because you're being seen of men. No, I'm trying to be an example. You have to examine my heart. I'm not trying to be seen of men. I'm trying to get that contagious in this church because when you live to give, I'm telling you right now, if you're a rich man who is stingy, you're just a poor man with money. Did you hear that? That's what we're coming for right there. I know a lot of people like that. You can be rich and stingy, but you're just a poor man with a lot of money. Learn how. You say, well, Pastor, I'll be generous when I have more. The way to be generous when you have more is be generous when you have less. Because money only reveals who you already are. Oh, my goodness, what a grouchy Wednesday night crowd we have tonight. The offering's already been taken. You don't have to panic. But that really is true. Come on, let's learn how to live to give. What a fun lifestyle it is when we learn how to live to give. It is more blessed. Jesus' words, more blessed to give than it is to receive. Now, you need to receive so that you can give, but it's more blessed to give than to receive. Now, I challenge you, Saturday at 5, Sunday at 11, come on out and be a part of that and bring somebody to the house. So pleased to tell you that last weekend there were 11 more people that gave their lives to the Lord. See what happens when you bring somebody to the house. People give their lives to the Lord. 322 folks have given their life to Jesus just since January alone, just in the church services alone. Me and Brandon are so stoked about that. Now, look at your pastor. I want you to really understand something here. As always, I try to communicate in a really effective way to everybody so that we understand things. Darius, a while back, asked me a very, very good question. I've had a number of people ask me that same question over the years, not with anything but a great heart. And I think that question is representative of enough folks that I want to at least talk to you about this so that you understand, because I want you to get this very closely. You say, okay, 322 people, that's a lot of people. Do they all stay in church? Do they all get water baptized? Do they all continue on and become disciples? I wish I could tell you yes, but I can't. So let me explain a little bit about that so that you'll understand the process of the gospel very, very, very clearly. There are two parts to the gospel. In Mark chapter 16, Jesus said, go into all the world and proclaim the gospel, and whoever believes will be saved. Then Matthew's counterpart of the gospel, in Matthew chapter 28, he says, go into all the nations, the Greek word ethnos, and proclaim, teach the word of God, and make disciples in all nations. Notice the phrase, make disciples. Mark 16 is making converts. Matthew 28 is making disciples. How many know both parts are valid when it comes to the gospel? You can't make a disciple until you make a convert. Once you make a convert, the goal is to never leave a baby at a doorstep. We want to take that baby into the hospital, and we want, obviously, that baby to grow in the things of God. Right now, Pastor James is teaching our new believers class. I don't know how many are back there, but there's a whole bunch of people back there now that have given their lives to the Lord recently, and he's training them, going to be doing that over the next four Wednesdays, the next steps in their walk with God. Now, are all 322 people back there right now? I wish, but that's not the case. But here's where I need you to understand. Same thing they always used to say to Billy Graham. Well, Billy Graham, he was the best evangelist, you know, in the history of the modern era. Billy, you have all these people that come forward in the altar. How many people actually get discipled? And there was always a vast difference between the two. But as I told Darius, and as I've told many people over the years, and as I want to tell you, Jesus already warned us about that. He prepared us for that. What do you mean? In Mark chapter 4, he gave a parable about the sower sows the word. And he talked about the sower sows the word, and he described that that sower was the Lord sowing the word of God into our hearts. And there were four different kinds of ground. Only one out of those four grounds produced. Right. Three out of the four, various issues, don't have time to go into it, stole the word of God from people, and only one out of the four produced. He went on to say in Mark chapter 4 and verse 20, out of the good ground, some produce 30, some 60, and some 100-fold. If you do the math, one out of four stay with the Lord, one out of 12 is a 100-fold producer. Jesus told us in advance, not everybody who is a convert is going to be a disciple. Now, do we do all that we can to make them disciples? You better believe it. That is our heart. We don't want to just have a bunch of numbers. And listen, here's where I get it. I know a lot of pastors and a lot of churches, they cheapen the gospel so that they can get a lot of hands raised and a lot of numbers. We don't do that here. You know that. We're one of the few churches that still tells people that they need to repent. Even that song, I like that song. It's a beautiful song, but it did not include repentance of sin. That was my one struggle with that. That's why if you notice, when I came up there, what did I say? How simple it is if you repent from sin and receive Jesus. Because there are two parts It's turning from doing things your own way, that's what repent means, and then turning to, it's turning from sin and turning to Jesus and putting all of your faith in what he did by his grace. Two sides of the same coin, repentance and faith, Hebrews 6, 1 and 2. So I do want you to see, a lot of pastors cheapen the gospel. They just say, well, you know, just receive Jesus, and people don't even know what they're doing, and a lot of people are lifting their hands. We very clearly explain the gospel, what it is and what it isn't. You have to repent of your sin. You have to know that you're a sinner. You have to know that you need a Savior. You have to now put all of your trust in what Jesus Christ has done for you. What has he done for you? He came from heaven to earth, lived a sinless life, the life that we could not live, died on the cross for everything that we fell short. Death couldn't hold him. He was raised from the dead. Now make him Lord and give him your whole life. We explain it very clearly. That's the gospel. He took our place. A lot of pastors don't do that. But listen to me very closely. I'm thankful for every one of those 322 people. You say, well, why do you count souls? Because souls count. And here's what the Bible says in Acts chapter 2 and verse 41. The Bible says that the very first sermon at Pentecost, the Bible says that 3,000 people were be saved. Notice they didn't just say a multitude. Right. There was a number that was attached to it. That tells me that there needs to be an exactness. How about Acts chapter 4 and verse 4? Another sermon by Peter, 5,000 people got saved. Not just, they didn't say a whole multitude, they gave a number. How many would go to a church where they count the money that comes in, but they don't count the people that give their lives to the Lord? That seems really out of whack to me. If money is important to you, that and I get it because it gives us the ability to reach people, that's great. But if you count the money and not the people, that is a mismanagement of priorities. The money is to be used to touch the people.
Could I have a better amen?
So we obviously want every one of them to be water baptized, and we have all of these things that we have in place where we can have a chain of events where they can be discipled and they can grow in the things of the Lord. Does everybody take us up on that? No, they don't. Do we want everybody to take us up on that? Yes, we do. But that's why I want you to understand, Jesus gave another parable in Matthew chapter 13. And he said, remember the parable of the wheat and the tares? There was a field of wheat, and then the Bible says sometime at night, the enemy came in and sowed tares. Tares look a lot like wheat, but they're not wheat. And then the workers in the field said, should we remove the tares? And the Lord said, no, don't remove the tares. Let the angels do that, because if you do that, then you're going to tear up the wheat in the process. Now, what does that mean? And I want you to understand that was a story, a parable, parabole, that Jesus taught so that you and I would understand the spiritual principle. In other words, we preach the gospel. People make decisions for the Lord. They say yes to Jesus. They repent. They commit their lives to the Lord. They put their full trust in him. Then we're going to have to leave that up to God, whether they're wheat or whether they're tares. Because he said, no, I don't want you people to handle it, because what will happen? If we handle it, we'll mess it up. We'll pull up all the wheat with the tares. If we start to say, okay, you're going to heaven, but John, you're not. And you're going to heaven, Greg, but Wally don't know about you, because you know how we are. We judge people outwardly. And that's why the Lord said, I don't want you humans doing that, because you people are turkeys. Okay, I added that. I'm going to leave that up to the angels so that they make right decisions. When we go to a missions trip, last time we went, there were over 1,800 decisions for Jesus Christ. Do I wish every single one of them got planted into the local church that we were working with? If they did, the doors would be blown out today. Do I wish that would happen? Of course. But all that we can do is preach the gospel and then set up a system that allows people to be discipled if they'll take advantage of that system. Don't you remember Jesus in John chapter 6? He just got finished feeding all the folks with the fishes and the loaves. And once again, there was a number. The Bible said he fed 5,000 men, not including the children and the women. So there's a number that mattered. And how many know everybody loves Captain D's? There was fishes and there was loaves, and the Bible says, and they were all filled, John chapter 6 and verse 11. The Greek word pleroo, which means they were stuffed. They were, it was like Thanksgiving. They were all stuffed. How many know everybody likes that Jesus that feeds you and gives you a free meal until you're full as can be, right? Jesus went right from that, and he started talking about, I'm the bread of life. Okay, Jesus, that sounds good. And then he started talking about, if you'll eat my bread and drink of my blood, remember that? John chapter 6. And then the Bible says that the whole multitude left him. Now, even Jesus had a problem retaining numbers. Oh, come on, somebody. I'm just giving you the Bible. And remember what Jesus said? Oh, no, we're ruining church growth. No, he looked at his disciples and said, are you guys going to go too? And remember Peter said, nah, where are we going to go? You have the words to eternal life. That was smart. So even Jesus' ministry experienced that reduction. There were multitudes that followed him to be healed and fed and on, but there wasn't a whole bunch of people that followed him as far as discipleship is concerned. So we're going to do everything that we can to preach the gospel and get as many hands raised as we possibly can. And then from that point, it's our goal to get them back in the new believers class, get them going back and connecting with our team so that we can connect them with the online, with our next steps, to get them to get regularly into church, to get them water baptized. We have systems for all of that in the church, and we're going to continue to do that. We've recently refined it so that we can make disciples to a better degree, because that's what we're all about. We don't want to just, how many know anybody can make a baby? Well, you understand my general point. Any man can make a baby. That doesn't take much to make a baby, but it really takes something to be a father. We don't want to leave any baby at the doorstep. We want them to come into the local church and grow. We've set in systems in place so that that will occur. So when we say 322, rejoice with us fully. That's a wonderful thing. And know on our end, we're doing everything that we can to fulfill both ends of that discipleship, making converts and then making disciples. You can't make a disciple without first making a convert. But once you made a convert, we're going to do everything we can to make a disciple. But you can't force people to be disciples. Jesus didn't. We can't. You can't. But let's do everything that we can in prayer and believing. I thought that was a super astute question, super profound question. And I thought that it would answer. I thought many of you may have that question. And I wanted to answer that for those of you that have that in your heart. So celebrate the 322. Believe with us as we continue to get more and more people born again, but also believe with us that we make more and more disciples. Sound good? Help anybody? That was just a little hors d'oeuvre. If you didn't like that, blame Darius. I thought that was an outstanding and a very warranted and a very wonderful question. Let's pray. Father, in the name of Jesus, thank you so much right now for ministering to our young teenagers back there with Cam. Father, I thank you that tonight, just like we talked about, there'll be lots of young people born again back there. Then, Father, I thank you that discipleship process really kicks in. Father, I pray that you would grow us tonight, all of us, 2 Peter 3:18, that we would all grow in grace and knowledge tonight. And I pray, Galatians 4:19, that Jesus Christ would be more formed in us. And, Father, I pray it and say it in the name of my Lord and best friend Jesus. And if you agree, would you say amen. I'm so glad that you're here tonight. You came just in the nick of time, and we're thrilled to have you. We're going to be talking to you about, after that little hors d'oeuvre, we're going to be talking about the Sermon on the Mount. We've been in that for quite some time. I have a feeling that we will be on that when Jesus comes back. How many agree with that? We'll be raptured, and we'll just finish the series up top. It won't be hardly any better than it is now. So let's review. Let's take a look at where we were in Matthew chapter 5. Let's look at verses 13. We're going to go all the way through 16, and then we're going to break it down, see how far we can get tonight. You are the salt of the earth. Everybody say, that's me. Just say it out loud. Say, I'm feeling a little salty tonight. But if the salt has lost its savor. Now listen, those of you that are new here, the New Testament was originally written in what's called Koine or Common Greek. It's my second favorite language is Greek, and so we bring it out from time to time, or quite often, really, to help you, not to impress you, but to bless you, to help you understand some of the context. That word, or that phrase, lost its savor, is one Greek word, the Greek word moreno. We actually get our word moron from it. Would you look to your neighbor on the left and no, don't do that. And so I do want you to understand, lost its savor means things have become without flavor, without taste. They become foolish. There are ways that we as believers now all of a sudden can become moronic when we compromise with the world, or we're so foolish or believe something so foolish, like half the YouTube prophets are trying to get you to believe, that you lose your savor. People don't respect you anymore because you're nuts. And you ever meet what I call a Star Trek cushion? How many remember Star Trek? Remember, boldly the front of it was boldly going where no man's gone before. I know what I call Star Trek Christians, boldly going where the Bible has not gone before. Ah, remember that little, and beam me up, Scotty, and everything is a Klingon, and on. No, please don't be that way, because you'll lose your savor when you're so weird. Now I want you to stand out like a healed thumb. No question about it, you and I ought to be different than the world. I'm not talking about compromising with the world or being like the world, but don't try to be weird. If you go into Kroger's and you're praying over the cabbage heads and the guy comes over and says, why are you doing that? Well, the Bible says, let us pray. You are weird. And don't you tell them that you go to Joy Church. You tell them you go to some other church. Wherewith shall it be salted, if thenceforth it's good for nothing but to be cast out and trodden under the foot of men? As I shared with you last Wednesday, that's what would happen with salt that has lost its savor. They would put it on the dusty roads to keep some of the dust down, and people would literally walk on it. Jesus knew that, and he's figuratively talking to you and I. But notice here, you're the light of the world, a city that's set on a hill. Ever say set? That word set is the Greek word keme. Keme means to be placed in a very strategic way. I'm going to bring that out if we get to it tonight, because you are a light that is set. In other words, where you are right now, where you work right now, where you go to the gym right now, where you are in your neighborhood. You just think you bought a house. You just think you got a job. But God, at least for now, has set you there, placed you there strategically to be light. And if you stop thinking of your job as just the way to pay the bills and start thinking of your job as a ministry where you've been set, placed strategically by God, Pastor, I'm in the midst of a lot of dark people where I work. Exactly. That's where you shine the brightest. The staff says that to me all the time. Notice here, a city that's set, same word, on a hill and cannot be hid. Next verses. Neither do men light a candle and put it under a bushel, but on a candlestick, and it gives light unto all that are in the house. How many know that our light needs to shine most brightly in our home? How many know if the people that know you the most respect you the least, there's something wrong? Oh, it got awful quiet in this house. Let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and think well of you. No. And glorify the Father which is in heaven. Now let's break it down. As we've talked to you before, social media. You know that term social media? just started in 1994. There was no such term until 1994, social media. Now, how many know that's just all over the place? There's so many people that use X and Facebook and TikTok and you know, all the interweb stuff that Chad talks about all the time. And listen, look at the stats. They're really pretty powerful. Check it out. 4.89 billion people interact with social media. 6 billion people interact in 2 years. In just 2 years, there'll be 6 billion people. This whole term didn't come about till 1994. And how many know, Tori, we live in a very, very, very dark world? And I'm telling you, we need to shine our light like never before. If you don't believe we're living in a dark, decaying world, please ask this dad. Check it out.
Tom, what's going on? I heard you across the street. You know this truck inside and out.
Now, what would you do if your daughter quit on your family? I mean, completely disrespected all your family values.
I'd tell her to get out.
Exactly. Jody comes home today. She says, Dad, I quit this family. Go ahead, just cancel my allowance now. Rent out my room. Take all my clothes and just chuck them out the window. Why don't you take my stereo, my laptop, my phone, my TV, give them away. Take all my jewelry, give it to charity. Take my brand new car and sell it. Grab my house key so I can never come back again. Go ahead, disown me and never speak to me again. As a matter of fact, write me out of your will and give all my shares to my brother.
We're talking about sweet little Jody here.
Jody.
I remember when y'all brought her home from the hospital. There's no way she would say anything like that.
That's what I heard.
Well, what exactly did you hear?
She said, Dad, this is my new boyfriend. He's an Ishigan fan.
Bring it in, man.
Pray for me.
Yes, sir.
It's a dark, dark world out there, people. Brandon knows exactly what I'm talking about. We need to shine like never before, even amongst cheaters. I feel so much better today, and so does Brandon. We live in a dark world. Come on, we need to be salt, we need to be light, and in essence, Jesus is telling you and I that we need to be social influencers. That's a big term right now, is influencers. Now, I want you to think about this. Let's talk about it. Let me show you. Socrates, he was alive for 40 years. He was a big influencer. Plato, 50 years. Our next one, Aristotle, 40 years. And, of course, the Taylor Swift, the 10 years. And all of that together, that's 140 years worth of influence. Of course, I'm kidding about the last one. But I want you to see the greatest influencer of all time. It's amazing. The greatest influencer, Jesus Christ. In 3 years, Jesus never painted a picture, yet some of the greatest pictures of all time are of him. Jesus never wrote a book, yet some of the greatest books of all time are about him. Jesus never composed music, yet some of the greatest music of all time is about him. Jesus was and is the greatest influencer of all time. Come on, give God a better thanks. Now, here's the key, influencers. Now he's handing the keys of influence to me and to you. In these verses, he's saying we need to be salt and we need to be light. So let's break it down and let's talk about it. First thing that we need to talk to you about is reviewing and sharing the salt. Remember we talked to you about that, how important that is. Jesus said to Emmy, Jesus said to Aaron, that we are the salt of the earth. Remember, at the time in which this was written, there was no ice, there was no freezers, there was no way of purification. Salt was as valuable as gold. You've heard the term, he's not or is not or is worth his salt. That literally comes from the Latin salarium, where we get our word salary from. And so I want you to see how valuable this is, that you and I are the preserving agent of this culture. We are and should be the biggest influencers out there. We talked to you last time about how to share the salt. Three salt standards. Salt makes you thirsty. You know that. That's our goal. When we're sharing the salt with people that don't know the Lord, we should make them thirsty for more of God. Second thing that we talked about last Wednesday, salt should be in our words, our work, and our witness. Third thing that we talked about, number three, is we ought to be the salt of the earth. Notice it doesn't say to be the salt of the church. We're the salt of the earth. How many understand that if we're the salt of the church and all we do is have our little holy huddles, you're sitting next to salt right now. Salt is sitting with salt. We're already salty. We're not supposed to be salt of the earth or the church. We're supposed to be salt of the earth. Next thing that we talked to you about last Wednesday for salt of the earth events, it's go ye, not stay ye. Talked a little bit about that. We don't want to have our holy huddle. This is simply the church service. After it's over, that's when you, the church, begin. I'm so thankful to God that we don't just have our little holy huddle. We fill you up with the Word of God, and then you go into your job, and you go into your gym, and you go into your college, and you go wherever God has placed you, and we are to be salt there, the preserving power everywhere we go. Second thing we talked about, salt, close to salt does not flavor the food. You know that. Again, two salt shakers next to one another doesn't make your steak taste any better. Third thing that we talked to you about, number three, get out of your holy huddle and pour out salt through your words, work, and witness. Fourth thing that we talked about is salt that's lost its savor. Once we begin to compromise, once we begin to be so foolish that nobody respects us, this life point really is true and it's powerful. We lose our saltiness when we become more interested in conforming to the culture instead of transforming the culture. Come on, ladies and gentlemen, you and I are supposed to be different. Not different weird, but different good. We ought to have joy when everybody else is bummed out. We ought to have peace when everybody else is freaked out. We ought to have faith when everybody else is scared. We ought to have confidence when everybody else is uncertain. We ought to have purpose when people have lost their vision. Boy, that's it. We ought to have character when everybody else is cutting the corners. We ought to tell the truth when everybody else is lying. Ought to be something different about us. Now that catches us up to date. Are you ready for new territory? Not only are we supposed to be the salt of the earth and share the salt, but the second thing that we need to understand, ladies and gentlemen, is now we need to shine our light. And that's exactly what Jesus said. So let me give you, yes, 10 light lessons. And we'll see how far we can get. The purpose of light is to penetrate the darkness. That's why Jesus calls you and I. Remember John chapter 8 and verse 12? Jesus said, I am the light of the world. But remember Philippians chapter 2 and verse 15, where the Bible tells you and I, in a crooked and twisted generation, that you and I should shine our lights among men or among mankind. You and I ought to be the light of this world. We ought to penetrate the darkness. Second light lesson that really is true. I'm more concerned about the absence of light than the presence of darkness. I've said this over and over and over to you. I know it's getting dark out there, but Isaiah chapter 61 through 5 prophesies very clearly. In the last days, watch this now, there's going to be darkness on the earth, Jared, and gross darkness on the people. But the Bible says right in the midst of that, the glory of the Lord will rise up on His church and be seen on His church. In the midst of darkness, that's when we shine the brightest. Doesn't bother me at all that this culture is getting darker and darker. It just allows our light to shine brighter and brighter and for us to make such a big difference. And I want you to know, whether you realize this or not, people are hungry for the Lord. They are hungry. I just caught a moment ago the eyes of the wardens. How many know every good prison needs a warden? Well, we have two of them right here in this prison. The wardens there, a number of months ago, they were two people, just like we talked about, that lifted their hands and said, yeah, I want to be born again. I want to receive Jesus as my Lord. And I've been watching them. They've been coming ever since. They come on the weekends. They come on Wednesdays. She comes to our Bible school class. They are becoming disciples of Jesus Christ. Come on. Somebody encourage the two best wardens in town. I'm so proud of them. Now listen to me. I am not concerned about how dark it gets out there. People are hungry, like the wardens, for the Lord. I have, about 5 years ago, God really put it on my heart, and I've been sharing this with other pastors, to make sure that we make the gospel very, very clear. I don't want to make false converts. I don't want to make people that just lift their hand and pray some dumb prayer for the pastor that somehow placates them and they think they're going to heaven when they've never had a heart change. Right here, this young lady right here gave her life to the Lord, and she keeps coming and coming and coming. Every time I've told that story, normally she stands up. She's getting a little bit tired, I guess. Where she's right now, all the people, yes, yeah, hi. Nice. And there we go. Thank you. I want you to know, I am so proud of her. I'm so proud of the wardens. People are hungry to give their lives to the Lord. About 5 years ago, as I was sharing, I really, really wanted to make sure that the gospel here at Joy Church was crystal clear so that people understood what it was so that they could get legitimately born again. And listen, folks, and let me stop and say something here if I could. I shared this a little bit with the Bible school last night. But I watch a lot of people over the years. You know, as a pastor, I watch sometimes the same people. Sometimes they'll lift their hands over and over and over again at altar calls. And I understand there are times where you're really trying to connect with God and you don't maybe fully understand things, and then maybe the nickel drops on something. But listen, if you're unsure of your salvation, listen to me very closely. I want to help you connect here, because you cannot, you can't really live a strong Christian life until you are sure that you are saved. Well, say, okay, Pastor, how can I be sure? Listen to me very closely. The Bible says, this is not on my notes. This is just, I'm being led by the Lord. Titus chapter 1 and verse 2, the Bible says we have to have confidence in eternal life. The Bible says in John chapter 10 and verse 28, no man can pluck you out of God's hand. The Bible tells you and I very clearly in 2 Timothy chapter 1, 12 through 14, that God will protect what you have deposited in him. But you have to guard what he's deposited in you. What is that? He'll guard your salvation. It's up to you to guard the word of God. Because it can be stolen from you, according to Mark chapter 4. How about Jude? What chapter? Just one. There's only one. Ever say, hey, Jude. Jude verse 24, the Bible says, watch this now. Now unto him that's able to keep you from falling and present you faultless unto God. Now listen to me very closely. That is the Lord's responsibility. So I want you to understand, if you've been legitimately born again, you've repented of your sin, and you put your full trust in the Lord, you can be sure that you have eternal life. But you cannot base that assurance on how you feel. Because how many know, listen, I'm a pastor. I've been in ministry 41 years. There's times I wake up in the morning and I don't feel saved. Come on, somebody get real with me in the house. There are times when my wife and I are having Holy Ghost heated discussions that I don't feel saved. But I don't question my salvation whatsoever. Why? Watch this now. 1 John 5, verse 13. The Bible tells you and I, these things write I unto you, that you may know that you have everlasting life. Not think. So listen to me. Your salvation is not based on how you feel. It's based on what the Bible says. If you are, and you know you've been born again, don't let the devil lie to you. You go back to the Word of God and you say, I know, I believe that with all of my heart. I repented of my sin. I turned to the Lord. I believe that He died for me. I was a sinner. I needed a Savior. He died for me. He took my sins on the cross. He was raised from the dead. He's alive forevermore. And I put all of my trust in Him for my salvation. And what the Bible says, not my feelings. Sometimes I feel like a nut. Sometimes I don't. Your feelings are up and down and all around. Feelings are meant to be felt, but never meant to be followed. And the moment that you get off the feeling roller coaster in your Christianity is the moment that you'll steady out. Your Christianity will always be like this if you live by your feelings. Yeah. Always. I got off that train a long time ago. I thank God for feelings. God has them. He gave them to me. They're meant to be felt. They're just not meant to be followed. I let them in the car. I just don't let them in the driver's seat. I love it when I feel saved. I love it when I feel spiritual. I love it when I feel the presence of God. I hear that term all the time. I feel the presence of God. I hear preachers say that all the time. I feel the presence of God. And I'd like to really break that down with you, because what does that mean to you? Well, I feel goosebumps. I can go in a freezer and feel goosebumps. I love this song. Well, I've been watching a beautiful commercial. It just touched me so much. Here's Jesus, and it was just awesome. I started crying, and then it came on from the Church of the Latter-day Saints. Folks, a cult made me cry because I was following my feelings. And so I understand the presence of God. I've been in the presence of God before where I feel things and thank God, but I don't live for that. And I know when I die, when I take my last breath and my spirit is released to heaven, the Bible says, 2 Corinthians 5:8, to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. I have zero doubt of where I'll go. And it's not, now look at your pastor. It's not because I'm a pastor. And it's not because I live a holy life. And it's not because I have the book of Ephesians memorized. And it's not because I know Greek words. It's because, the reason you're unsure is because you're putting some of your trust in your goodness. Put all of your trust in His goodness. Stop putting your trust in your accomplishments or lack thereof. Put all of your trust in His accomplishments, what He did. I put all my trust in what He did. I put all of my trust in what the Word says about my salvation. And my salvation and yours, if you'll do that, will be safe and secure. You can go from think so to know so. And the moment that you go to know so is the moment that you really start living. Because you've got to have confidence, Titus 1:2, in eternal life. 1 Corinthians chapter 15 talks all about that. One of the problems in Corinth, they had all kinds of problems at Corinth. In 1 Corinthians chapter 1, they're fighting over who they should follow. Should I follow Peter? Should I follow Apollos? Should I follow Paul? Or should I follow Christ? They're fighting about that. In 1 Corinthians chapter 2, they're fighting about what it means to be spiritual or not. In 1 Corinthians chapter 3, Paul said, I have to write to you carnal people because you guys have divisions and you're fighting and there's all kinds of mess in between you. 1 Corinthians chapter 4, Paul had to straighten out their understanding of a true apostleship and faithfulness in that. 1 Corinthians chapter 5, Paul had to address that there was a dude sleeping with his stepmom. Whew. I mean, you think the American church has challenges? The church of Corinth was a mess. Their guy was in incest. And Paul literally had to say, what is wrong with you people? Why have you not judged this? Well, judge not, you shall not be judged. Why have you not judged this? They weren't in trouble because they were judging. They were in trouble because they weren't. In 1 Corinthians chapter 6, he had to tell them, you guys are a mess because you're all going to court and you're suing each other, brothers and sisters at the law, and you're making a mockery. Judge Judy thinks you people are crazy because you're making a mockery of Christians when these things should be settled amongst yourselves. In 1 Corinthians chapter 7, he had to write to single people and tell them, here's how you touch one another. Don't do it with lust. You ought to read the Bible. It's phenomenal. In 1 Corinthians chapter 8, he had to talk about the whole issue of, okay, this food was offered to an idol. Is this okay? Is that okay? And not causing brothers to stumble. In 1 Corinthians chapter 9, he had to say, look it, you guys are not supporting the pastors financially. You need to do that. In 1 Corinthians chapter 10, he had to talk to them about they were in trouble because they were acting like the children of Israel, fornicating and complaining. In 1 Corinthians chapter 11, he had to talk to them about the communion table. They were getting drunk at the communion table. So don't you people have homes? You ought to read 1 Corinthians 11. It's awesome. And he had to talk to the men and the women because they were indifferent in Corinth. The women were on one side of the church and the men were on the other side of the church. And they were standing up in the middle of the service yelling at one another. And he's saying, you need to go home and talk about this. This is crazy. It's causing craziness in the church. You ought to read the Bible. It's awesome. In 1 Corinthians chapter 12, he had to talk about the gifts of the Spirit and how out of order things were. In 1 Corinthians chapter 13, he had to say, you guys, this is what it's all about. It's about love. Don't you get love? This is what the whole thing is for. 1 Corinthians 14, he had to straighten out the spiritual gifts and the ministry gifts. In 1 Corinthians 15, I got there. That was my whole point in the first place. He had to straighten them out about the resurrection. They were struggling because there was Gnosticism coming into the church. And they were struggling with it. Oh, man, I don't know. Did someone really raise from the dead bodily? This was a spiritual thing. That's Gnosticism. And Paul had to say, of course they were raised from the dead physically. And he made a case, if the dead aren't raised, then you and I are still dead in our trespasses and sin. Now, I want you to think about this. This is something that will really help you understand your salvation. And this is huge. There are a number of things that will testify to the strength of your salvation. Number one, the Word of God. We just went over that. But number two, the Spirit of God. The Romans chapter 8, verses 15 through 17, the Bible says that if you're a child of God, the Spirit of God will bear witness to you that you are a son or daughter of the Lord. Let me explain what I mean. When I was a dirtbag sinner, I've been in ministry 41 years, but 44 years ago, I was an alcoholic chicken at ease at a bar. Every intention that I had, or almost, was selfish or evil or lustful or greedy, or that was my fallback. You know how on a computer you can program it to fall back to a certain thing? When we make an investment or something, I get on Fidelity, I have a fallback thing, so it goes right to my account number. Write it down. I'm going to tell you right now my account number. Ready? No, okay? And so it's a fallback. And when I was a sinner, my fallback was always to do evil, always to think about me, always if I could take advantage of a girl, or on and on and on. That was always my fallback. Ever since I've been born again, I don't always do the right thing, but my fallback is to do the right thing. Now, that's my own personal miracle, and that's your personal miracle. When you get born again, if you're truly born again, in your heart, not always in your appetites, in your body, not always in your mind because it's not yet renewed, but in your heart, if you're truly born again, you want to do what's right. That's why I struggle with someone who's been quote-unquote born again for 20 years and you can't see any change in them at all. I struggle with that. You might want to take another dip under the blood. Because if you're, again, I totally get it. There's a bunch of people right here, they just got saved. So they're in the process of renewing their minds and give them a little grace. Could I have an amen? Remember what a mess you were and I was when we first got saved. So give them a little grace and space. But you've been born again 20 years and you still hate black people? You got to be kidding me, dude. 1 John chapter 4 and verse 20, the Bible says if you love God, you ought to love people. You know you've been saved 20 years and there's no change, and there's your fallback. I mean, it's like, dude, listen, I don't always do things right, but in my heart, and your heart, if you've been truly born again, you want to. That's your fallback. Man, to me, because I was such a hedonistic sinner before I knew the Lord. To have that kind of a thing, man, you can't talk me out of Jesus anytime, anywhere, any place. I don't care how smart you are, because I know what's been done in my heart. My fallback was always to do what was selfish. My fallback now is to do what's right. I don't always do what's right, but that's my fallback. God has changed my, not my blood pump, but my spirit from darkness to light. And if you're born again, that's what's happened. Amen. And that's a real major proof. 1 Corinthians chapter 15 says, if you don't believe in the resurrection, you're still dead in your sins. That's why I know he is alive, and I know I am saved, because I'm no longer dead in my sins. I used to be. That was my fallback. But now I'm born again. Don't always do what's perfect. Don't always do what's right. But I sure do want to. So to me and Brent. By the way, I'm so proud of Brent, one of our new ushers in the house. I just love him. I really do. I just love him, and I'm so proud of him. He's been coming out for quite some time. He joined the team. He's just a brand new usher back there learning. Wonderful man of God. I just believe in him and appreciate him, and I'm just so glad God brought you. Come on, encourage Brent. Come on. Come on. Really do. So I'm sorry. I got all excited, but I wasn't planning on talking about any of that, but I don't want you struggling, and I don't want the devil messing with your mind, trying to convince you that you committed the unpardonable sin, or your salvation is not sure. I've had so many people over the years say, oh, Pastor, I'm committed the unpardonable sin. Listen to me. The very fact that you're struggling with it means you haven't. And I don't have time to explain the rest. So that just will tell you right there. If you're struggling with it, means you haven't. People that committed unpardonable sin, they don't care. Don't care. Their heart is hard. They don't care. They never will. But the fact that you care, the fact that you're struggling with, the devil's lying to you.
That's right.
Man, how to get on all this? Someone must have needed this tonight. A little sidetrack. Earlier was the hors d'oeuvre. This is the dessert. Good preaching, someone said. Thank God bless you. Thank you. Thank you. You're the only one. All right, I won't go too much farther than that. But I don't want you to have a think so. I want you to have a know so salvation. You got to be confident in that. It's one thing I'm just completely, I have zero doubt, zero fear. Whenever I go on to be with the Lord after I've satisfied with a long satisfied life and accomplished what God's called me to accomplish, zero fear. It'll be an adventure. Never been there before. But I'm excited about it because I'm going to be with my Lord. Paul said in Philippians chapter 3, he said, it's far better. Everybody say far better. Come on, say far better. Sorry, Philippians chapter 1, it's far better to be with the Lord. Not just better, far better. Huporeno in the Greek language. Far better, not just better, far better. Paul said, I want to go to be with the Lord, but to stay with you is better. For you. Not for me, for you. So I'll stay for you, but I want to go. Most of us will say, okay, I'll go, but I want to stay. Paul said, I can't wait to go, but all right, I'll stay for you turkeys. He had a whole different attitude on that. He couldn't wait to be with the Lord. Don't you, Christian? No Christian should ever be afraid of death. And until you get over the fear of death, you will never learn how to live. And I don't mean be an idiot. I don't mean going to the Hell's Angel Motorcycle Club, kick it down. You know, Sue Dilt's kicking it down. Hey, kick down the door. Y'all get saved, bunch of Hell's Angels. If you do that, you deserve to die. And you will. So I don't mean be an idiot, but I don't mean don't live in the shadow of the fear of death. It's just a shadow, folks. Third thing that you need to know, check it out. Light shines the best and brightest in the darkest places. And why is that true? I kind of tempted to have them turn off all the lights, but I know how you'll be. You'll be just like junior hires. You go, ooh. The fourth thing that you need to know, number four, come on. You're right there. There you go. Without light, we die. What do you mean, Pastor? Well, just think about it naturally for a minute. Can we? Without light, plants can't grow. No photosynthesis. No plants, animals have nothing to eat. Without plants or animals, we have nothing to eat. You die without light. Same thing when it comes to spiritual light. Think about it this way. 2 Corinthians 4:4. What does the devil do? The Bible says the devil is the god of this world system. Watch this now. He blinds the minds of sinners lest the glorious light light, light, light of the gospel shine in. The devil's number one job is to blind sinners to the glorious light of the gospel, however they can. And that's why you hear me say it all the time. I talk about this on a frequent basis, and that's why I need people to help me. When I'm doing the altar call on Saturday or Sunday, you know I give you 40, 45 minutes of my best teaching, mature stuff. Last 5 minutes I give to people that don't know Christ, people like the wardens were, people like my buddy was here at one point, people like I was 44 years ago. I give my last 5 minutes to the people that don't know the Lord. Don't turn me off because you're saved. Don't start thinking about where I'm going to go to lunch. Participate in the altar call. How, Pastor? By quietly praying, not shuffling around, not checking your phone, not being completely insensitive to people that don't know Christ around you. Because you'll be used to help blind the minds of people. If you're kicking over your coffee thing, I cannot tell you how many times the whole sermon goes great. Last 5 minutes, I preach the gospel. Ba-ba-bing, ba-ba-bing, cha-cha-ching, wah! Every baby cries. Everything gets kicked over. Everybody's shuffling. The people in the back rows that aren't really supposed to go into a ministry assignment are moving. Everybody's checking their phone. That is a part of blinding people's minds to the gospel. Don't you be a part of that, Christians. Come on, I need your help. You can't be that spiritually obtuse where you don't care about people that don't know Jesus. You say, well, Pastor, I don't really have a compassion for souls. Listen, please. I told this story to my leaders, some leaders on Sunday night. I'm going to tell it to you here. This is it's a true story, such an impactful story to me. I'm going to tell it to the on the weekends as well. So you're my guinea pigs. But this is so powerful. True story. In Florida, there was a guy on a boat, and he hit a cement pylon that was submerged or something, and he got thrown off of his boat. And it was unconscious. They fished him out. He had swallowed a good bit of water. And so they were giving him artificial respiration. That, you know, they brought him up, giving him artificial. And there was this guy that saw the whole thing from a distance. Oh, gosh. And, you know, you watch it as you would like the news or something. And so as they were doing this artificial respiration on this guy, they turned his head towards this guy that was observing. And all of a sudden he noticed, that's my brother. Everything changed. Now he's not just a spectator. That's my brother. Look at your pastor. Every person that doesn't know Jesus, we just kind of step back as a spectator. But if you'll just pray with me, if you'll just focus with me, if you'll just bring people to church, that could be your brother or your sister. Quit looking like a spectator. Well, they're all going to hell. We got to care about people that don't know the Lord, not just other believers, and on social media too. And I care deeply about other believers, of course. Do good to all men, Galatians 6:10, especially them of the household of faith. That's believers. But I want you to understand, there's a whole lot more folks that could be our brothers if we'll stop just spectating. Oh, come on, let that impact your heart. You say, I wish I had more of a passion for souls. Listen to me. I have a total passion for souls, but do you know why? Look at your passion. It's going to help you. Because I have a passion for God. I have much more of a passion for God than I do souls, but because I have a passion for God, he gives me that passion for souls, because that's his passion. And if you care about him, you got to care about what he cares about. Man, I hope you're getting that. What I just said is working. What? Think about it for just a minute. Listen, you know your pastor. I love people. I'm one of these pastors that loves people. But can I tell you something? The stuff that I do, I don't do for you, I do for him, and I love you. He's my biggest motivator. He should be your biggest motivator. And his heart is, listen, you know what I'm talking about. Anybody got multiple kids? You got more than one? Come on. You don't, how many got more than one kid, but you won't raise your hand because you hate them? Okay, okay. Now listen, you know, I've told this story before, and you know it's true. If you got multiple kids, like Pastor James, he's not here, he's with the new believer, so we can make fun of him, right? He's our resident Catholic. He's got 47 children. Who knows how many kids he has? Yeah, I've lost count. Listen, he's got six kids? He's got six kids. Look, trust me, if he's all with all the little kids, and they're so cute, they range in ages, all the little, I mean, dear me. And they're just the little kiddles are just so cute. And if all of a sudden, he's got six of them, if all of a sudden one gets lost, he doesn't give a flying rip about the five ones that are with him. Everything stops. Kids, where's the little one? All right, you, fan out. You, do this. You, do this. You, don't do anything. You're a brat. You. Everything stops. No one cares about the found kids. We care about the lost kid. Jesus gave us parable after parable in Luke chapter 15. Lost a coin. Don't care about the ones I found. I sweep the whole house and find it. Lost a sheep. Don't care about the 99. Let's go after the one. A prodigal. Man, as soon as he came to his senses and took the first step, here comes a father. Comes a running. God's heart cares about the lost. Lost things are valuable things. If you really love God, you're going to care about what he cares about. And he cares about people that are lost. I want this church, starting with this pastor, to be salt and light wherever we go. And I'm just so proud of the Smiths. They've led people to the lamb. They have this little dog. Their dog is their fishing lure. And I love that. Their dog is very cute. And they take the dog everywhere they go. The dog is like their child. And they take the dog, and people love the dog. And so they'll use the dog as like a fishing lure to connect with people and then lead them to the Lord and bring them to church. I kid you not. Guys, I'm proud of them. That's what we do with Kairos. Kairos is our cute little dog. Right. I really do mean that. What's your cute little dog? What's your Kairos? Yep. Maybe it's you decide I'm going to buy donuts for everybody at the workplace. Yeah. Just everybody. I'm gonna bring donuts for everybody. Every Thursday I'm going to start doing that because that's my ministry. These people need Jesus. Yeah. Well, you don't know these people. That's why God set you there. And why do you do that? You know, you're not jamming everything down their throat. Why do you do that, dude? Well, I'm a Christian, and I just follow the Lord, and I just care about you guys. I want to bless you. Just a little salt. Maybe that'll make them thirsty. What's the deal with that, dude? Maybe they're not ready yet. But maybe one day now they're going through a divorce, and they remember the donut guy. Hey, dude. Here comes the tears. Now their heart's open. Now you can lead them to the Lord. Now you can take them to church. Now you can be salt. And now you can be light. Helping anybody today? Did you learn anything? I preach myself happy. Preach myself happy. Father, let the people of Joy Church care about the lost. Father, just build that heart in your people starting tonight. Let them care about the lost. And Father, I pray it in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Help you tonight? Come on. That's good. That's good. Bless me. Well, we have Cam here. That's why we do all kinds. That's why this Thursday, which is tomorrow morning, pray about that. We're going to go to Cumberland College, and we're going to feed hundreds of kids. And the whole purpose of that is to help them come to Jesus. And then we're going to invite them to the Camp Bab thing Thursday night. That's our little dog. We're doing stuff like that all the time, and we're never going to stop. We're going to keep discipling you, give you as much word as you can handle. But folks, you can't be just so, you can't be what I call a fat and sassy Christian. It's just about feed me, feed me, feed me, feed me. And I'm just fat and sassy. I know the Bible. I know Greek words. I can win a Jeopardy tournament. No. Don't be fat and sassy. You want to be trim and slim. You want to take it in and then give it out. Take it in and then give it out. Don't just eat and exercise. Oh, come on. I'm talking figuratively, people. Figuratively. This is a parable. Come on, eat and exercise. Let's grow together. Come on, let's say goodbye to all of our online folks. Say it with me as my connection pastor comes back. Say it with me like you mean it. God loves me as if I am the only person in this world to love.